kadamba sandhi pitaha sadari dayai kamdare spuratuva sachinandana vancha kalpa tarukrasya kripa sindhu vayevacha patitanam pavadevyo vaishnavevyo namo namaha Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadhadha Srivasari Gaurabhaktavinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram Hare Ram 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 Hare Hare First of all, I offer my unlimited anarpanas unto the lotus feet of my Paramahansa Guru Paramatma Om Vishnu Paramahansa Parivraja Acharya Ashoka Vesapta Srila Bhakti Vedanta Nai Goswami Maharaj and I pray for his offer's mercy unto his dearmost friends and eternal associates Srila Bhakti Vedanta Balan Swami Maharaj Srila Bhakti Vedanta Trivikram Goswami Maharaj I offer my unlimited Dandalan Panams and pray for their causeless mercy on to the lotus feet of Srila Govinda Goswami Maharaj. Today we are observing the glorious festival, how he entered into Lila pastimes, how he departed from this world in such a glorious way in the holy town, Sri Mayapur Dham. On this most auspicious duty, we are remembering his glories and we are praying that he bestows his mercy upon us, that we may realize his most auspicious and transcendental example and his outstanding teachings, that we will be blessed by his causeless mercy. Today we are praying for the unto the lotus feet of Srila Bhakti Vedanta Swami Maharaj, Srila Prabhupada, Srila Bhakti Pratyan Keshu Goswami Maharaj, Srila Bhakti Rakshak Srila Goswami Maharaj, and all the eternal associates of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada, I am offering my unlimited Dhanavat Pranams and praying for their causeless mercy. Unto the lotus feet of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Goswami Thakur Prabhupada. Today we are observing his transcendental appearance in this mortal world. Right here in Puri, he appeared every day almost. We are visiting his birthplace where he manifested his appearance pastime. And how he established the glories, the Manovish of Sitipari Mahaprabhu Shri Goswami Prabhupada, and how he inspired so many wonderful transcendental personalities to distribute the teachings of Prem Bhakti all over the planet. In the sky, everywhere, the whole atmosphere, by his powerful preaching and example, has become most auspicious. We are offering our Mahamudanavan Pranams unlimited times and pray for his causeless mercy unto all pure Vaishnavas, Vaishnavis, transcendental, spiritual, ideal teachers. We are offering our Mahamudanavan Pranams unlimited times and pray for their causeless mercy. To all the devotees who are assembled here, headed by our glorious Tridandi Sanyasi Dham and senior Vaishnavas, Srila Prakasapra Prabhu, Bhopadev Prabhu, all the disciples of Srila Bhakti, Vedanta Swami Prabhupada. I am offering my humble Dhanavat Pranams and pray for your causeless mercy. So today, most auspicious day, Puji Bhattai Kanaswaraj is with us again. Beautiful. Saraswati is smiling also. This is a good sign. Today we are observing very auspicious festival. Today in this holy place, Jagannath Puri, appearance of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada. What are his glories? And what are his ideal teachings? And we will hear today from Lotus Mouth of Rivera Sanyasi and Vaishnavas who have assembled here this morning. Also, we want to hear especially the glories of Bhakti Bhaktisiddhanta Gour, Govinda, Saraswati Maharaj. He appeared not far from here, in a small village. At that time, the village, I heard the district name, perhaps Jagannath Pura. Jagannath Pura, yeah. And the Gadaigiri was the village? Gadaigiri, yeah. And he was born in a very religious family. The Giri family, yeah. They were very famous for kirtan, I heard. And they were invited. Always they could come and do kirtan in front of Lord Jagannath.
They were the first.
Yeah. The first. And Srila Govinda Maharaj is from his early birth. Yeah. He was always absorbed in worshipping their deity. And also Gopalji. Yeah. He was studying. At the age of 5, he was already remembering all Bhagavad Gita, studying all granthas from his parents and grandfather, perhaps. I have heard all these things and how he was so much attached to Krishna Bhakti. At the age of 45, he left his home, his family, his children. He was responsible to maintain whole family. He was a teacher. He studied. But really he was always speaking about Krishna Bhakti, even to his students in school. He could not stop. Wherever he would go, every day he would perform devotional activities first thing in the morning. And in the evening also, speaking Harikatha to whomever he could. At the age of 45 he left his family, everything, and he went to search for his eternal master. Although he had read all the scriptures and understood the philosophical conclusions of the scriptures, really he wanted to know the essence of the Yuga Dharma, that is the chanting of the holy names. How I can enter this most valuable treasure? I need to find my eternal master. Where can I meet him? So he went to Himalayas and he had many discussions, debates with Mayavadis and so many spiritualists. Then he came to Vrindavan, finally, perhaps in 1974 it was. 1974, I think. He came in Krishna Balaram Mandir. How? Somehow or other, when he was in Vrindavan for 2 weeks, he met with the devotees, the representatives of Srila Saraswati Goswami, who had taken shelter and so much inspired by the ideal Guru Padmapa.
He got her back to Godhead.
Yeah, I'm coming here. Yeah. He met the devotees in Vrindavan who were fulfilling the manovis of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada by distributing the teachings, the glories of Sri Yuga Dharma, Sri Nam Sankirtan. This is called the Brihat Mardanga. So even in Vrindavan, the devotees were distributing back to Godhead magazines. And he got one and he read the magazine articles. And he became so inspired, he wanted to meet Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada. So he came to his Kon Mandir. And then, as he was entering the room of Srila Prabhupada, how he entered, I don't know how many obstacles he passed, but he entered by Srila Prabhupada was
respecting Mahaprasada. And Srila Prabhupada told him, so you have come, you should take sannyas at once. Without any delay, Srila Prabhupada advanced so, and Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj realized, this is my eternal master. So from that, so many beautiful ideal pastimes manifested. After his taking sannyas, he received the order of Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada to go to Orissa and start one temple here. Although there was nothing, only jungle. And so many animals were living in the jungle. Dako is also a he would go in the jungle and translate the books of Srila Prabhupada into Oriya language. And he would go door to door to preach the glories of Krishna consciousness. And who was bringing him from door to door? One rickshawala at that time. He had a bicycle, and on the bicycle he had these flat mats. And Srila Gaura was sitting on the bicycle, flat mat behind, and going from door to door different houses. And that the person who was driving the bicycle became his disciple. That is Satchidananda Prabhu. He became disciple of Srila Gaura. Very beautiful Vaishnava. Now he is at present in Dandabanga. Actually visit that place, very special place. Now, Srila Gaura Govinda Maharaj, he came in fulfilling the desire of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Swami Prabhupada. And Prabhupada visited him in 1977, perhaps. The last place that Srila Prabhupada established in this, putting the cornerstone, was here in Bhuvaneshwar. And he stayed with Srila Gaura Govinda Maharaj in some very humble settings. Although the devotees had rented a very nice, luxurious hotel room for Srila Prabhupada, he said, no, I will stay with my devotee. Yeah. And he stayed with him in mud hut for 17 days. And what they discussed, only the two of them know. Yeah. Nobody else. They were fully absorbed in speaking Harikatha and relishing Krishna consciousness. The bliss of Krishna consciousness is realized when there is high class Vaishnavas discussing Harikatha. And what are they discussing? We have no idea. Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, Mantri, and his godbrother, we have heard Srila Bhakti Rakshakshita Goswami Maharaj. And they were discussing Harikatha in the early days of the society, the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. After they came out from the room, they heard from Bhaktivedanta Padmanabha Maharaj. Achyutananda Prabhu was there at that time, Achyutananda Swami Maharaj. And he asked, what did he discuss? He said, I cannot tell you, right? It is.
He said, if I tell you, you will faint.
You will faint. Yeah. So we are discussing very easily the things that are very high. Yeah. Yesterday also we heard some very beautiful topics in Gambira. Actually, these are meant for only few select persons. So we were lucky yesterday that we were there and heard from lotus lips of Krishna Chandra Prabhu, the beautiful pastimes of Radha and Krishna. But these are not worldly activities. They are the topmost transcendental bars, loving expressions from the perfect personalities. So we want to hear more glories, especially from our sannyasis. So this morning we became very happy that on this day, Srila Gaura Govinda Maharaj departed from this world. But here in Puri, His Holiness Srila Bhaktivedanta Shakti Maharaj appeared, who is the intimate disciple of Srila Gaura Govinda Maharaj, together with Yayanta Krishna at that time. They stood up for the real principles of Guru Tattva in Mayapur. We want to hear from Maharaj's lotus lips how Srila Gaura Govinda Maharaj entered the eternal pastimes of his beloved Radha and Krishna, his Istadev. How he entered in that time, you were there perhaps, in Mayapur at that time. But you remember the past time. We want to hear from Srila Prabhupada. And after Maharaj has spoken Harikatha, then we will request our Srila Bhaktisidhanta Padmanabha Maharaj and Srila Bhaktisidhanta Tridhari Maharaj to also extol the glories of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada. And especially, don't forget, although he is taking a humble position, but he has a very unique way to glorify our transcendental Guru Bhagavan. So we will also request His Holiness Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Baikanas Maharaj to speak and to give the audience the inspiration and transcendental ideal conceptions of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada and Srila Gour Govinda Goswami Maharaj. If on this day we are glorifying these great personalities, certainly their mercy will come to us. Certainly. They will be very happy. And if we do not glorify them on this day, we cannot obtain their mercy. So I'm giving now, with permission of Senior Vaishnavas, first the floor to Srila Saraswati Maharaj. Yeah. He's sitting next to me. Yeah. He is very eager to speak the glories. Hare Krishna. Once a we have some time. I'm requesting all speakers to keep it 20 minutes, like that. Then we can all have a chance to hear from all the seniors.
Yanam Janana Shrakaya Shaksurumita Tasmay Shri Gurave Nama Manchavaka Padrubhyascha Kipa Sindhubhya Ivacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Nama Ajanuram Bitabhujo Kanakavadato Sankirtane Kapidaro Kamalaya Takshu Vishvambara Pijabaro Yugadharma Paro Vande Jagatriya Karo Karuna Vataro Kanaka Jaranagatro Niyasana Janitro Vigamara Parabaro Marati Kundamaro Tarataru Navesho Niyapitam Varesho Smarani Vritani Kunje Radhika Krishna Chandro Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Sadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare. So first of all, I'd like to offer my unlimited posthumous Nandavat Pranam in the dust of the lotus feet of my spiritual masters Harinam Guru Shachi Chi Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, Srila Prabhupada, my Diksha Guru, Srila Golgovinda Goswami Maharaj, my Shiksha and Sanyas Guru, Srila Bhaktivedanta Narayana Goswami Maharaj, all Rupanuga Guru Varga, Vaishnava Acharyas and all Vaishnava Acharyas. Please accept my Dandavat Pranam. Do you have some water? So today is a very glorious day that we are celebrating the Disappearance Day of Srila Gour Govinda Goswami Maharaj. He was serving his Ishtadev in Bhubaneswar. One time we asked him, why don't you preach in Vrindavan? Then he smiled and he said, in Vrindavan, Srila Bhaktivedanta Narayana Maharaj is preaching. In Puri, in Mayapur, Srila Bhakti Pramod Puri Maharaj is preaching. Now I am preaching here. So he has so much respect for the Vaishnavas. He knew Saraswati, so when we came to him, we didn't know anything. So we taught. He taught us everything, A, B, C, D, X, Y, Z, everything he taught. So we were amazed at what we learned from him, because In ISKCON, we heard all the general topics which we find in Bhagavad Gita, Srila Prabhupada's Bhagavad Gita, which was very, very nice, very, very inspiring. But when we came to Govinda Maharaj, we heard things that we never heard before. Things like Shiksha Guru Tattva. We didn't know what was Shiksha Guru Tattva. What was Guru Tattva also? What was Sadhu Sangha? We never heard all these things. So we were amazed and we were drinking this nectar of his lips, his harikatha, from his lotus lips. Like, you know, like drinking, like unsatiated. Because nectar means it is unable to satiate yourself. So we were listening and listening so many of his harikatha day and night. His harikatha was very powerful. He was starting a class in a very, very humble way. We could hardly hear his voice. But after three words, Satam Prasangam Mama Virya, some video. The power with, and the room will vibrate and the walls will start shaking. And then all the devotees, you could see their eyes will open, their ears will become like this. And as he was giving us this kind of treatment every day, we were fighting to come and sit in the front. So even new devotees, they didn't know anything about bhakti, but they would come and push us. We were a proper disciple. They would push us on the side, just sit in front of him, Bhakta Swarup. He was new, but he was pushing all of us. He was so greedy. And Gour Govinda Maharaj, he had one habit, which was actually, we saw that Gurudev was doing also the same thing. He was speaking in the eyes of the audience. And he was speaking of one special devotee that he wants to enlighten, that he wants to, you know, transfer his mercy. So he was looking in his eyes. And one time, Sudhaveti Maharaj Jayantakri that time, he didn't want to sit in the front because he was the receptacle of the Gour Govinda Maharaj's mercy. He was a friend from previous life also. Both together they were so good friends. So this day he didn't want to sit in the front, so he sat behind me. And he was hiding. And Gour Govinda Maharaj was looking, where is this? Then he saw him and he said, you sit here. So he sat in front of him and he started speaking for 1 hour in his eyes. And then Jantakrit, for a little speck of time, he looked on the side. Big mistake. biggest mistake of his life. He got so much thunder, so much chastisement. He said, how dare you do this? Huh? I'm speaking to you and you're looking outside, on the side. Huh? And Jantakrit was frozen. And again, for 1 hour, speaking in his eyes, going into his heart, and putting so many things.
What was he telling him?
Yeah. He said, are you interested by Krishna? Because the deity was like this, on the left side, and outside was right side. So he said, are you interested by Krishna, and he was showing the deities, or are you interested by Maya? And he said, you are all attracted by Maya. Like this, you know, you are all attracted by Maya. You are Maya Das. And he would speak so strongly that even after his classes, 1 hour, 2-3 hours after his classes, we would remember all the points, one after the other. We would go in our rooms, like he would say, like on the appearance of Advaita Acharya, I remember, one, but there's so many. He would say, Advaita Acharya, he said, if I cannot bring the Lord down to this earth to save the fallen souls, I am not Acharya. My name Acharya is useless. So he gave his words and his promise that he will make the Lord appear. So in this way, Advaita Acharya was crying loudly and offering Tulsidis and Ganga Jal to the Lord in order to make him come appear. So he said, in the same way, you have to cry and promise that you will make appear the Lord in your heart in this lifetime. And that message was so strong that whenever the class was finished, we would go to our room and we would go like, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 appear in my heart. Hare Ram, Hare Ram, 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 Hare Hare. We would be like, you know, becoming completely, you know, a changed person. A change of heart would take place, you know. So powerful class. You never forget his classes for the rest of your life. So, but he was a very kind person also. You know, like we heard about Pragnakesha Maharaj's appearance, disappearance day, a few days ago. He was also, before becoming a devotee, in his younger age, he was so kind to all the peoples that he had some, you know, welfare activities going on, helping old ladies who were sick and everything. And he was also sacrificing all his pocket money that his mother was used to give him to help those people. So that was his kindness. Actually, Bhakti Pramod Puri Maharaj said that Bhakti Pragnakesha Maharaj was the most kind of all of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur's disciples. So Govinda Maharaj also, he had this side of being very kind also. One time, one old Baba came and knocked at his door. They were very poor at that time. And that Baba, he was kind of begging and crying, please, I have nothing to cover myself. It's cold outside. I have no home to sleep in too. So please, you give me some blanket or anything. So Govinda Maharaj, they were also very poor. They had a big, big blanket for five children, his wife and himself. They all were having only one big blanket for the whole family. Can imagine, you are sleeping all together. And so he gave that blanket to that poor person. Then his wife came in the evening and she looked and she said, where's the blanket? He said, I gave it to some poor person. She said, what? Where will we sleep? How will we protect ourselves from the cold? He said, we are in the house and he was outside of the house. So I gave him preferences. And he gave the blanket to that poor person, you know. That was his, you know, very soft and sweet mentality. And so many times, you know, like he was, Prabhuji was telling how his disciples, his students heard very early Harikatha. He was a teacher, but teaching what? Of course, academics sometimes, but mainly Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, he had realizations on those books early in his life. So he would always speak about these things.
Many of the students became his disciples.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. You know, usually we know that once the teachings have been given, the pupils, they leave their professors not to keep any relation with them. This is in Shastra and other examples of the same thing. But in the case of Govinda Maharaj, his students, they became his disciples. They followed him through one type of knowledge to a superior type of knowledge, transcendental knowledge. They had so much appreciation, you know, that they couldn't leave him at any moment. So they became his disciples and they followed him for the rest of their life. So therefore, there was a very big groups of devotees who want to take initiation from him. But although ISKCON devotees, they had gurus from very beginning after Gour, after Srila Prabhupada left, they installed themselves into guru positions. But they had no authorization, no permission from Prabhupada to do that. He didn't give any permission, you know. But Gour Govinda Maharaj, like he spoke about such a number, Prabhupada, who became sannyasi, you know, is such a number, Saraswati. When Prabhupada came for the installation of the temple on Nityananda's appearance day, Sachinandan Prabhu, he asked Prabhupada, can you give me initiation? And Prabhupada said, no. You take from Gour Govinda Maharaj. You know? Because he needs somebody to help him, so you will be able to help him very much. So therefore, you take from him, you surrender, and your life will be perfect. So, although there was a very big number of people who want to take initiation from Gour Govinda Maharaj, he never said anything to the GBC. When the crowd became pressurized, then one day he approached GBC with a letter that Prabhupada said, you should have your own man to help you in the instructions that gave you to develop this temple, to preach all over the world, and to translate my books. He gave him three instructions that he actually performed perfectly. So he came to the GBC and he showed this paper that Prabhupada wants me to take disciples. And GBC read and said, okay, you can be a guru. Then he became a guru, but not an ordinary guru. Because many disciples of different ISKCON gurus, they were going to him, flocking from all directions, and taking shiksha. It was never heard about in ISKCON to take shiksha from another person. So many gurus, when they heard the disciple saying, may I take shiksha from Gour Govinda Maharaj? They would say, no, I can give you everything. Huh? No, you stay with me, or I will reject you. I will give you back your karma. I don't know how it's possible, but anyway. Even if they took any karma from them, then they want to give it back. What a transaction. Anyway, so they would come. He had disciples of more than 25 gurus. You know, you can imagine. Tamal Krishna Maharaj, Giri Maharaj, all these greats. They were losing disciples coming to Gour Govinda Maharaj. And he will teach them very, very nice Tadvasiddhanta. Yeah? And they would become very enlightened. They became more advanced than their gurus. They became much, much more advanced than the gurus. So, can you imagine the situation, you know? So there was a turmoil in ISKCON at that time. Because his disciples, they were so enthusiastic, they couldn't control themselves. And they would say, Guru Tattva! Guru Tattva! Guru must be pure devotees! And in ISKCON, they knew we are not pure devotees. We are maybe Madhyam because we are preaching. But this I put into questions. So anyway, they were thinking like this. And there was a disturbance. Because Gour Govinda Maharaj said, Guru must be pure devotees. He must be in bhav. So they wouldn't be able to digest this, to swallow this. So they would make a big problems to him and to his disciples also, especially. One year they made so much problems that Gour Govinda Maharaj said, what is this? I am preaching what is in the books. Why are they making so much problems? I'm not making any compromise. I'm preaching Tadvasiddhanta, Guru Tattva. They were thinking, oh, he's saying his guru is pure devotee because he thinks he is pure devotee. When he heard that, he became very much disturbed. Somebody said, he is preaching Guru should be pure devotee because he thinks he is pure devotee and nobody else. So he became very, very depressed. He said, how can they think like that? I'm preaching Guru Tattva. This is all over in the books. So they were giving so much trouble to his disciples that he decided to fast completely in Mayapur festival. He would fast for days and days. And then they came and they apologized. And after some time he took again some prasad and all that. So he was connected to Bodhyamat, very much connected. Not like the others. He had some Shiksha Guru in Bodhyamat. One day, one very special Babaji, a disciple of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswatika, who came to Bhubaneswar to meet him, just prior to GBC meetings, this personality would come and bless Govinda Maharaj. So when he arrived, I was sitting next to Janataki, Sudhadvaiti Maharaj. And Sudhadvaiti Maharaj became all of a sudden completely enlightened when he saw him. I saw what happened. Look at this personality. Who is he? My lips is moving. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna. By looking at him. I said, oh, let's go and see him. But Govinda Maharaj came out from the hut and he brought him inside his hut to discuss something. So Jayantakit wants to go inside, but he would not let him come. So he remained there for 10 to 20 minutes, then came out, and before leaving the place, he would go to this staircase leading to the temple and pay his roundabout pronounce to the deity without going, because he was lame, you know. He was like walking very slowly, somebody helping him. So he would go slowly, slowly, you know, touching the ground like this, and then he came back, and we were all lining up, very, very much, you know, aware of this great personality being here in this temple. So he came to us, and Janatakit was first, and another person was second, I was in third, fourth, and fifth position. There was five devotees lining up. Then he came to Janatakit, and in Orillian languages asked him, are you speaking Orillian? So Chantakrit, he knows a little bit of all languages because he's good memory. And he said, no, I don't speak Orillian, in Orillian language. So he said, anyway. Muria koi
pari
Yeah, like this. So anyway, the Babaji, he opened his arms and he embraced him. One time, two times, like this, two sides. And Jayatakrit started crying, you know. You could see his tears coming out very, very strongly. I looked and said, wow, what's happening here? Then second person came. When he touched the second person, that person also started crying. I said, wow, my God, I'm the next. What will happen to me?
Fakir Mohan. Who's that
Babaji? Not Fakir Mohan. No, no. Bhakti. I can't remember. Sometimes the name comes, sometimes I forget.
Disciple of Bhaktisidhanta.
And then came in front of me. I was not accustomed to embrace sadhus, but he opened his eyes and he grabbed me and I touched his left side. He was so skinny, you know, I could touch his ribs and everything. So skinny. When I touched his left side, I started crying. Then, when I touched his right side, I cried more. I couldn't stop crying. Like Ganga and Yamuna coming out. I couldn't believe, who is this person? Amazing person. Then he did the fifth and the fourth, and then he went back to his rickshaw, and Govinda Maharaj came out at that time. And he took Govinda Maharaj in arms also. And Govinda Maharaj, just like a child, he put his head on his chest. Then he put his hand on Govinda Maharaj's head and he caressed him very nice, soft, slowly, went down like this. And then he put his hand on Govinda Maharaj's head and he looked into his eyes, you know, and we could see that he giving some mercy, you know, with his eyes, you know. And I have seen also his eyes also when he touched us. Was amazing, you know, when he was speaking to Janataki the first time, we could see that he was not in the same world as we were. His words was coming from another words,
across and coming into our ears. You know, we could see he's not from this world. It just appeared that he is a nonsense, but he was not in this world. We could see for sure. Then, after he did this Govinda Maharaj, then Govinda Maharaj went back into his heart, and then he left. Then Janatakrit. Then somebody said, can I go in behind him and take pictures? He said, no, don't disturb his bhajan. So then Janatakrit asked Govinda Maharaj, he said, is he one of your Shiksha Guru that sometimes in your classes you mention? Then Govinda Maharaj, he said, yes, he is one of my Shiksha Guru. He taught me Rasa Tattva. He is always in bhava. He doesn't go down from that stage. That's why he doesn't speak. But he gives his mercy by hugging and embracing. This is how he gives his mercy. So today you got his mercy. So that was his very nice experience. I had some experience with Gurudev also, in a different way, but same nice feelings of, you know, ecstasy and everything. Gurudev has the power also to give this also, in some occasions. So, that Babaji left, we never heard again about him. So we saw a video of him when he was leaving this world. Bhagavan went to give him, to see him, to meet him in his little room. And he was so humble, you know, when he saw Govinda Maharaj, he couldn't actually walk. He went like this to Govinda Maharaj, begging for mercy because he was going to leave this world. So, how great Vaishnavas, you know, exchanges. You know, one is giving mercy, then the other gives. Like this, this is a world of mercy, you know, this never stops, never ends, you know. He said, I give my Dhanavad pranams to my Gurudev, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj Prabhupada. Just like the ocean in Jagannath Puri, every waves of this ocean is giving Dandavat pranams to Jagannath. Every moment there's a wave coming and crashing on the banks of the beach, the shore. So as many waves comes and leaves, the Dandavat pranams to Lord Jagannath Balabhadra, I also do the same to my Gurudev. So he was very, very much Guru Tattva to Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj. Never, never, even in dream, deviate from his instructions. That's why he was, you know. When Prabhupada gave him this project in Bhubaneswar, he didn't know what was that. It was given a place in the jungle. And dacoits were living there, and many, many wild animals also. So when he asked the rickshaw, can you bring me there? The rickshawwala said, yes, I can bring you, but not there. I will stop before. You will have to walk. This place is very dangerous. I am not going. So he left him, and he walked towards that place. Very dangerous, dark, jungle place. And then he stopped working, you know. He didn't have any place to. So there were some works doing on the highway. Highway number 5, Nayambali. There was some work going on. So they had little cabins, and he would sleep there in the cabin. And they were hammering all day, you know, making up. And then for prasadam, he would go to the Vishnu temple in Anantavasudev. So he had to cross the whole city to get prasadam and come back in the daytime and do his works, you know. So I was very fortunate that one time in France, I become restless, I didn't want to go out in Sankirtan anymore. I said to Bhagavan that I want to go on Harikam. So I went to India. I went to Rishikesh. We knew about Rishikesh. So I went there. And then I heard some GBC gurus were in Mayapur coming now, where I was 100% peaceful. Aside for you. So I said, let's go. I will go to Puri first. And then I will go to Maya. So I took a flight and I arrived in Bhubaneswar, and one taxi man said, I give you a ride to Puri for 100 rupees. And I will stay there for 3 days and wait for you, and then when you come back to the airport, I will take you back to the airport for 100 rupees at that time, 81, 82. So very nice. I said, yes, okay. Then on the way, through Bhubaneshwar, he said that you have a center here. I said, really? Oh, I never knew. He said, I can take you on the way. I said, okay. So we went and he stopped me across the highway, Mayapali highway, highway number 5. And then I looked and I saw a little hut and I saw one big devotee coming to me. His name, you all know, is Bhagavat Maharaj. He was there with Govinda Maharaj. Prabhupada had given him instruction to assist Govinda Maharaj. So he was there. Then when he saw me coming out of the taxi, he came across the street and he took me. He said, I want to introduce you to a sadhu. So I said, oh, very nice, let's see. And so I crossed and I went there. I walked towards Govinda Maharaj. And he didn't see me, but as soon as he saw me, he paid his namaskar. He was sitting and immediately when he saw me, before I could do anything. So I was very surprised. I paid my namaskar. When I stood up, I felt, wow, so much nice energy running into my body because he had given me some, attention, So I was very surprised. And he was translating Prabhupada's books into Korean language. So I said, oh, this is the activities of an acharya, because I knew Prabhupada. And then Bhagavat Maharaj said, yes, this is the activities of an acharya. So I didn't stay there. I didn't know at that time he was going to be my Diksha Guru, of course, but I was the first person who ever taken the initiation for me who met him. So I was very lucky. Then I left. So there's many stories. He was also sometimes very strong with his disciples, I heard recently that actually a real Vaishnava is strong. He would not let his disciples do any kinds of nonsense. He wouldn't say, okay, no problem, you can do, okay, you'll be chanting then this, that, and everything you do. No, he was very strong in some cases. There was one devotee, he had met a very beautiful hostess in the flight, and he became attached to her, and they got married. So that devotee, he talked to that lady. And so they were to marry. They marry, and then he told her, you go to Bhubaneshwar and wait for me. I'm just coming after a few days. So she came, but she was not a devotee. She was dressed in a very short skirt, here. And go, mini skirt, And I don't know how much dress she had, but anyway, I wasn't there. But Sobra, it's a temple of Brahmachari, So when Brahmachari told Bhagavan Maharaj, this is a very strange lady, just in the middle of the courtyard. So Bhagavan Maharaj said, oh, who is she? Why she came? So he came out and he asked her, who are you? What are you doing here? What's the purpose of your visit? And she said, I am the wife of Ananta. Sorry. Anyway, it's a great devotee, So anyway, so he said, oh really, you are the wife of this devotee, and you came here, so now as you come, you go. As you enter this temple, now you come out and you disappear and don't come back. And she was so shocked, surprised. She left, never to see her again. Then another came. Have you seen my wife? No, I'm telling you, I don't know. But Govinda Maharaj called Ananta. He said, please, this is complete Maya, What are you doing? Are you crazy? You're going to lose your life. You're going to lose everything. Why don't you become a little sober? I will finish you. Then he said, you have to sleep in the reception room. Not in any bed. You sleep on the floor, reception room, next to the suite room. And no mosquito net. And you're not allowed to go out of the compounds of the temple. Only to do Harinam Sankirtan. So for 1 week he went through this. And in every classes he was chastising. Anantamaya Das. Anantamaya Das. He is Maya Das. And his friend, he had a friend. Very good, you know. He knew everything. He knew everything. He was Maya. And he's also in Maya. But he never said anything, so he went to help his friend. He kept, both of them kept themselves in Maya. Can you believe this? Ananda Maya Das boy. Then he said, just like one time there was a man, he was walking in the street and he met a friend. He made friend with a person he met in the street. They discussed all day long. Very nice. Then at the end of the day, that person who met the other said, I am going back to my home. So I am going to take rest. So the other said, oh, very good. I'll meet you tomorrow. He said, where are you staying? Oh, I have no place to stay. Oh, no problem. You can come to my house. I have a big king-size bed, you know, big bed. You can sleep in one side, I sleep on the other side. Oh, thank you so much. Very nice invitation. Oh, my God, you saved my day, you saved my life. So he said, but there is a problem. I have one problem. What's the problem? He said, nine times I pass you in the bed. You pass you in the bed? Yes. That's no problem. Because I also pass you in the bed. So, lying different side, you pass you in the one side, I pass you in the other side. No problem. So Govinda said, in the same way these two. Huh? They're in Maya. And there is no problem. We can stay in Maya. What's the problem? We will manage everything. In this way. So he was chastising him. So then after that became pure devotee. And he could give communication skills to everyone. How to behave, how to... Then he became so open.
And now he's
serving Fatima. And now he's serving Fatima. He was a driver of Govinda Maharaj.
He's become renounced.
He became so renounced. No? One day he was taking Govinda Maharaj to a program. And then he was driving the car, and then they came to a bridge which was broken across the river. Then one big truck crossed the river next to the broken bridge. So water was coming, you know, coming up. But the truck made it through, the heavy truck. Then Ananta was looking, Govinda Maharaj said, should we go? What should we do? Govinda Maharaj said, go. Then they went slowly, slowly, you know, in cars, moving here. But anyway, they made it. So they went to the programs. And then, after the program's finished, they had to come back, just the same way, but it was night time. And Govinda Maharaj was in the car and was smiling and laughing. So Ananta the problem was thinking, I know why he's laughing, but now we're coming to the river. We have to cross again. Then again, they had to cross in the dark, the river. And actually, they made it. And they came back to that. Everything's fine, like this. So there's many things, you know, many things he did, which was very amazing, very, very astonishing. So we may talk a little more tonight. Any disciples of Govinda here? No? Who knows?
We are all six
disciples. Okay. He had all of our Gurudev's books. Every time was book of Gurudev was coming out, Ashram Maharaj would come and give a book. I said, what do you think about it? So his shelves was full of Bhagavan Maharaj, of Srila Narayana Maharaj's books. And he met also Srila Narayana Maharaj's books here in Shinganya, Prabhu's house there.
I remember that in 94 we met him in Holland, and the Nectar of Govinda Lila and Beyond Vaikuntha was just printed. And then he gave to Govinda. Next morning we came, and the servant said he was up all night reading the book from cover to cover, finished. He was so eager.
He was such a sincere devotee of Prabhupada that Srila Bhaktisiddhanta and the Swami Maharaj used to say he is the best and maybe the only devotees of Bhaktisiddhanta Swami Maharaj and Srila Prabhupada. He fulfilled all his desires, you know. He made a temple which is like a palace. And instead of living in this palace, he used to stay in the hut. Very simple. Things, sleeping very in the very small, very simple hut. He never took advantage, and he made such a nice restaurant. And he had deities of Gornitaya, Jagannath Balarama Subhadra, and Krishna Balaram. And Balarama three times. So after some time he thought maybe people are not coming because of there is no Radha and Krishna deity. So he asked to Srila, they installed deities of Radha Gopinath. And I think Srila Gurudev made the installation ceremony, Pratishtha. I think they went there, and on the side of the compound there's a very nice, small, beautiful temple.
And Gurudev also installed Srila Gaurudev's deity also.
Also, see, the connection is there.
Gaurudev also installed his own hand.
After Samadhi,
so,
you mean?
When he left his body, I was ready to go and travel with him all over the world because I would hear the reports. And they were so nice, you know. Sometimes I felt, wow, so nice reports. One time he was in Africa and nobody was coming to the airport to pick him up. So he was staying half an hour, 1.5 hours. Where are the devotees? And then all of a sudden he heard a kirtan, but not an ordinary kirtan. An African tribe kirtan. African tribe. You understand tribe? Yeah, we're doing Hare Krishna, but the way of African tribes. He looks at this kirtan and says, wow, he forgot all the pains and all the way he was staying here, you know. For 1.5 hour he was staying, you know, and he thought, nobody's coming, what's happening? And all of a sudden, this African devotees, going like this, you know, by Ashram Maharaj, like this, Hare Krishna, and he couldn't believe it, you know. One time also, they stopped him in Singapore.
So they picked him up.
Oh, yeah. They stopped him in Singapore, and they put him in jail for one day. And this, his assistant, disciple, said, should we take the Gornitai out of the box? He said, yes. They should know that we are in jail. And they also are in jail. So take them out and put them on the table that they are also detained. And they should know that we don't want to stay here. Me and them, we should not stay here longer. So he did this. So many nice things. I can't remember everything. It's thousands of things.
Actually, Srila Govinda Das, he said after completing the temple in Bhubaneswar, that was 1985, he said, this is not an ordinary temple. He said, I have built this to establish crying school. It's like we have to cry for Krishna. So beautiful. Very nice Harita. Now, although I have mentioned that everyone speaks 20 minutes, but this was like 20 minutes of Lord Brahma. Yeah, it was very nice. Very nice. Also, I have mentioned we will invite our reverse Sanyasi Gamba. In the meantime, our dearmost Mother Maharaj has arrived. Yeah. Although he is here already for 3 days, we could not have his, how you call it, auspicious presence in our Harikatha. So now I am requesting Puchipat Mother Maharaj to address all the sincere devotees in the audience and glorify Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada's transcendental, most wonderful appearance in this world, and also bring some beautiful ingredients in his Harikatha about Srila Govinda Goswami Maharaj. What is the speciality of this day? The appearance of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada, the disappearance of Srila Govinda Maharaj. How he, on this day, what is their most sacred relationship? Why he chose to live on this day? To give the whole world the message that this is the real position of transcendental personalities. They have very intimate relationships. So now the floor, you can stay there, Maharaj. I will bring the mic. Mic and reach somewhere. You go nice there. It's been all the devotees.
Avirbhutam sakarunam sivamananarayanam rupanuga pravarudho svikesavapriyo bhaje namam vishnupadaya krishna prasthaya bhutale Srimate Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Dinamine Sri Gurave Sri Gaura Chandraya Saparikari Yugal Kisaraya Cha Brajadhamaya Purusattam Chetraya Radhavanaya Cha Namo Namaha Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, all together. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama.
First of all, I pay my humble obeisances unto the lotus feet of my Paramaraja Gurupada Padma, Om Vishnupada Paramahansa Swami, Ashtotara Sata, Sri Srimad Bhaktivedanta, Srila Vamana Goswami Maharaj, and Om Vishnupada Paramahansa Swami, Ashtotara Sata, Sri Srimad Bhaktivedanta, Srila Narayan Goswami Maharaj. I pay my humble obeisances at the lotus feet of my spiritual grandsire, Sri Srila Bhakti Pradhan Kesav Goswami Maharaj, and Sri Srila Bhakti Vedanta Swami Maharaj and entire Guru Vargas. Especially, I offer my humble obeisances at the lotus feet of Srila Govinda Goswami Maharaj, whose disappearance today, and moreover, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Goswami Thakur Prabhupada, whose very auspicious appearance today. I convey my dandavat pranam, all Vaishnavas and Vaishnavi assembled here, presiding over by my uncles, like Sri Bhaktivedanta Padmana Maharaj, Sri Bhaktivedanta Vaikhanas Maharaj, and my god brother, my uncle here also, Prakasana Prabhu. No, I don't. Oh, because of God brother, like Dilani Maharaj, Shruti Maharaj, and all others. And to Bhopadev Prabhu. So, today, so we have to keep one point. So, first I discuss that point. Why Srila Gaur Govinda Goswami Maharaj choose this tithi to enter Nitya Lila? First we have to know, we have heard from Srila Gurudev, for what purpose Srimad Mahaprabhu came? Two reasons. One is his own, second for living soul. His own, Premras Niljas Karite Asadan, Ragmarga Bhakti Loke Karite Pracharan. He want to release the essence of prema rasa in Srimati Radhika's movement. This is his own. This is not for distribution. And second one, samarpayitum unnatojjala rasam sabhakti sriyam. He want to donate what anarpita charinchira. Anarpita means anarpita. This never, this never means one day of Brahma distributed. After that, long gap, he never distributed. So that he want to distribute. What is that? Sa bhakti sriyam. Sa means own. So bhakti means his bhakti of his own. Whole world is own. Moreover, Krishna told, mad bhakta vinodaya karumi vividha kriya. Why I am manifesting so many pastimes? To entertain my devotee, to please them. So mad bhakta vinodaya karumi vividha kriya. And what? So all the devotees is on. Moreover, devotee in Braj. Moreover, Sankha. Moreover, Vatsala. Moreover, Madhur. In Madhur also four types. Sapaksha, Vipaksha, Tatastha, Sridvaksha. Out of that, two cousin sisters is prominent. One is Srimati Radha Thakurani and other Chandra Hari. Our scripture telling, Tayopi Ubhaya Mudhe Radhika Sarva Devat Radhika Sarva Radhika. Out of two, Srimati Radhika topmost. So her bhakti seems beauty. What is that? We have heard from Srila Gurudev, it is called Bhavallasvati or Manjali Bhav or Tattal Bhavetchatmika Bhav. So Mahaprabhu wants to donate this to living soul like, fallen soul like us, without any caste country. Srimad Mahaprabhu's prema was deposited in two places. One place is Padma, where Ganges flowing in Bangladesh, Bangladesh they call Padma. When Mahaprabhu went to preaching in Bangladesh, he told, O Padme, I am depositing some prema with you. So whenever my particular devotee will come, you donate this prema to him. Padma Devi Ganga asked Prabhu, how I knew who is your near and dear devotee? Then Mahaprabhu told, Jahar sparche tumi odhi kuthaliva, narottam bali tumi tahare janiva. When by somebody is touching, all of a sudden, flood will come on you without any cause. Then you think that is my narottam. Narana uttama narottam was all living soul. When narottam Thakur came, when he touched Padma Ganges, all of a sudden it came up, then he donated this prema to him. This is anarpita charinchira's prema or sabhakti sriyam. And you know that how he preached. Second prema, Mahaprabhu, second place is Jagannath Puri. Srimad Mahaprabhu always observing three moods of Srimati Radhika. One is Vrishabhanandini, when he was in Navadvip. Another is Samyogini, when he was in Kurukshetra, went to meet Sri Krishna. Third is Viyogini, being in Jagannath Puri. So Mahaprabhu deposit prem here in Jagannath Puri. For whom he deposit? Vyasdev told, Jutkale Purusattamat. He Jutkale, if you disjoin Sandhi, he Utkale. Surely in Utkale means Jagannath Puri. He means Nishtit surely, Utkala means Utkal Pradesh in Odisha, Jagannath Puri. So who is that? How will you know? When, who is Mahaprabhu? Mahaprabhu Jagannath has no difference. And Jagannath Dev, Rajyatra is going on, he stayed there 3 days. Why? To want to meet with his near and dear devotee. Through whom you want to distribute? Anarpita charinchira prem or rasam sabhakti sriyam. So he stayed there. In excuse of annaprasan, he gave that prem, Mahaprabhu, through Jagannath Dev to him to preach. Now, so Mahaprabhu's prema was in two places. One is Jagannath Puri here, another in Padma. So why Srila Gaurabhanda must choose this? Srila Gaurabhanda want to show, or Prabhupada, Saraswati want to show the whole world. But what purpose I came? What purpose Mahaprabhu came? What purpose Rupa Goswami came? What purpose Guru Bhargava came? For same purpose, Srila Gaurabhanda came in this world. To show this, Prabhupada Sastakur called him, come in this day to me. And Srila Guru Goswami was so the whole world. I am coming for this purpose, for our purpose. Prabhupada Sastakur came to show this. You choose this day to disappear from this world. If anything wrong, then you can judge. So now I am coming to that point. Srila Guru Goswami Maharaj, when he met with Gurudev, Sinhania's place, 1993. And what question this guy only gave answer in one question in Gurudev Bible, second volume. And I give the bunch of list. Because some devotee has doubt he went there or not. After meeting with Gurudev, Srila Satsaru Maharaj went to Bhubaneswar. And it published in their magazine, is giving class there. So Satsaru Maharaj was with Gurudev. After meeting with Gurudev, then later on meet with Satsaru Maharaj. So I am working third volume now. I will get all answer of this. I have my diary, answer this question too, in third volume. Even the one of question was there, Srila Gurudev asked Srila Gurudev, that Manjaris also take part in dance dance or not? Gurudev, why not? What is the proof? Then Gurudev looked towards me. I told, yes, Gurudev, once he told an Iskan devotee is to come to you, and deep they are dancing, all gopis and manjuris also there, Radhika's ankle will get off. So Rati Manjuri dancing such a way, give a check to somebody, please. So Rati Manjuri dancing, and somehow she picked up and put in Radhika's ankle, all became surprised. Then she told, sorry, Krishna told Radhika, oh, your Manjaris are so expert. This one place, I told Gurudev. Another, Guru, any proof in scripture? Then Gurudev looked towards me. Then why looking towards him? But he will always supply me everything. He's my lucky second body of my shadow. Then I told Gurudev, let you remember, then Gurudev told the whole slow. But Manjaris dancing with Radhika and other sophis. Gurudev was very confident, so very few parts I knew about that. So also that meeting I will publish there, everything.
Shloka?
I don't remember.
Okay.
It will come in third volume.
Where is it? The shloka?
Krishna Bhavanamrit. Or must be Govinda Lila. The shloka Gurudev told from Krishna Bhavanamrit. So now I am coming. Prabhupada Saraswati Thakur. Prabhupada Saraswati Thakur, what was the predict 1 millennium before? Yudhkale Purushottamat. So Prabhupada appeared in Jagannath Puri place. When he appeared in this world, his whole body ornamented by auspicious tilak marks of Vaishnava Sampradaya. Neck beat and umbilical cord was like a secreted Hawaii. By his auspicious appearance, he wanted to show the whole world that he came to refute Mayavad philosophy and want to preach Vaishnava philosophy. This is first reason. And I told already Mahaprabhu was deposited, so he wanted to show the whole world. Every day we are reciting Prabhupada Svakam Sujanar Buddha Radhita Pada Jugam. Why Srila Bhakti Raksha Siddhar Goswami Maharaj use Sujanar Buddha Radhita Pada Jugam? He could not use other word. Prabhupada so many followers. Why Sujan? If you want to know, we have to go to Lotus Feet of Raghunath Das Goswami. He told, Guru Goshthe Goshthalai Sujane Pusuraya Gani. Sujan means they are Vaishnava, but not our Sampradaya. So Srila Bhakti Raksha Siddhar Goswami, I want to show the whole world. Prabhupada only, not honorable in Gaudiya Sampradaya, is honored by all four Vaishnava Sampradaya. So he used Sujanar Vidara Adhita Pada Jugam. Only our Sampradaya, glory will not be so vast. So Srila Siddhar Goswami, I want to show his lotus feet always worshipped by all Vaishnava. Upon Sampradaya, Sri Brahma Rudra Sana. So you want to show this. And Prabhupada Saraswati Thakur established 64 words in his lifetime. Why 64? Cannot do more or less? Why? He wants to show the whole world. What purpose your Rupa Goswami Pad came in this world? Want to show that bhakti, limbs of bhakti 64, what described by Srila Rupa Goswami Pad. Want to show that will come under his guidance. Easily they can follow the 64 limbs of bhakti. When our Param Gurudev, Vinod Bihari Brahmachari attend mod, and Prabhupada first lady disciple Saroji Basi Devi. One day Prabhupada is telling that I will establish 9 moths in 9 islands of Navadvip. Why? And Pishima told Prabhupada, you have no manpower, who will take care? Well, my Vinod will take care of everything. Why 9? Prabhupada wants to say that if you make it small, then from 64 to 9 limbs of bhakti. So which part for which bhakti is mentioned in our scripture? So want to show that want to preach 9 limbs of bhakti for small form. And Jagannath Dev stayed 3 days. Why? Want to show the whole world. Whose best day? Vyaso Narayanam Swayam. What best day has written? Want to prove this. So Jagannath came and stayed there to meet with Prabhupada Saraswati Thakur. Not only that, this is Saraswati Thakur's birthplace or not. Make it sure. 1979, in Cut Festival, at that time, Prabhupada's mother was somewhere, the team entered there. There are so many court cases, so many fighting took place. Even 79, first time when they came there, that what happened? Again, Chariot was there 3 days in that place, in the door of Chaitanya Gaudium nowadays. So this is the place where I met my near and dearest devotee, Bhaktisidhanta Saraswati Prabhupada. Prabhupada appointed by Bhakti Vinod Thakur, tutor of Manik Bahadur Manindra Chandra Nandi. Being there, Prabhupada teaching that boy, this body is temporary, we are refugee in this world. This body is temporary and perishable. And he is teaching him beside his school education. About this world, about this body, Guru Tattva, Vishwa, all Tattvas. Gradually, the boy became renounced because it's mentioned that Bhakti Yogam Prajajati Vasudeva Bhakti Yogam Gyanayati Asi Vairagam Gyanam Jayat Ahaitukam. That Gyan and Vairagam will be there, knowledge and renunciation coming. His wife became very disturbed, the queen. Kick out this tutor. I don't like it. Only one children. If you renounce, we'll take care of all this property. Manik Bahadur tried to make her understand level best, but not listening. So told, I am very, very sorry, your father, Bhakti Thakur, is a very, very good friend. But I'm sorry to tell you leave. Otherwise, it'll be very, very big domestic problem for me. What I'm paying? I pay every month, don't worry, but you have to leave. Being there, Prabhupada, there is a very huge Vaishnava library, read all books. They know it, but as a human being, first time they did so. And once, Manindra Chandra Nandi, he held a Vaishnava Sammelan. Prabhupada being 3 days, not eating, not drinking anything. When prasad is coming, for prasad it mentioned, Sustam Kurju Siddhan Bhapi Mitam Badura Desata Prapti Matrena Bhaktavam Nakta Kavala Vicharana. Prasad has come, Mahaprasad, maybe dry, maybe still not fresh, come for long distance, after all are immediate. What Mahaprabhu saw through Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, coming from Mangala, he was sleeping, not wash his mouth yet. Sarvabhauma, remembering this to then Mahaprabhu, today, my life is successful, my mission is successful to come in Jagannath Puri. The Prabhupada always take only one blessing. The pujari told to king, everybody is happy, everything going on, but one saintly person not taking anything. What? Why? Because did not give him scope to speak Hari Katha. Prabhupada's idea, if I not give anything, why take from them? Then Manindra Chandranandi came. Why not take him? Then Prabhupada told, do you think I'll be dog in my next life to pay your debt? I don't like that. Then he understood and then he allowed him to speak Hari Katha. Then Prabhupada gave him prasad. When Sri Gaurakrishna Dasavadi departed from this world, then deep in humility told, I could not serve Dham. After my depart, he can arrange any big rope and tie my both feet and drag me and throw in the Ganges. So Babaji's, they arranging all this thing to do that. Because why? Guru Radesha Chavicharaniya. The order of Guru must be followed without any consideration. When Prabhupada knew this, he came some of his disciples and told, stop! None can touch my Guru, only I am disciple of my Gurudev. I am no sticky brahmachari from my birth. Controversy going on, police came. In front of police, Prabhupada, Sishadev told, who never do Sri Sangha, he can come and touch my Guru, otherwise he will be turned into ashes. Even 1 year, 6 months, 3 months, 1 month, 1 week, even in last night, he's not thinking even his mind about any human, come and touch. It's a big disaster. So by this way, all of it, one after another, gone. Prabhupada, through my parameter, other, he brought and put him samadhi. How bold is this? And Prabhupada, Gaurakrishna told him, Kalika place, Kalkata, my mother, don't go to Kalkata, the place of Kali. But Prabhupada, Saraswati Thakur, first established mort in Kalkata, the Bhag Bajar. Now question may arise, if Prabhupada, he disobeys Guru, once I went with Srila Bhakti, which I am Jajaguru, Sai Maharaj, Srila Gurudev, then he was pointing, telling this poem. Then Prabhupada always tell, I never go out one step to the lotus feet of my Guru Padma, Srila Gaurakrishna Dasavadi Maharaj. So, Srila Jajavara Goswami and others, after Prabhupada's departure, they are discussing that why Prabhupada did so. Then Jajavara Goswami told, look, the Bichathara of Vinodda. They always tell Paramahansa Vinodda. Paramahansa told, if we disjoin Sandhi, Jhavicharaniya, he or suffix Vicharaniya, he means mischief or means assess Rupena and special way, have to judge what is Gurudev in our desire. Knowing this, if you do that, Guru Radesha Jhavicharaniya, by this way, he did. In his last days, Prabhupada gives some instruction that Sajya Karte Sekha Madhavasi Pradhan Kartabha. We have to tolerate. My Guru Maharaj should tell, Je Soy Seroy, who tolerate, he exists. And he's one of the many instructions of Prabhupada Saraswati Thakur. Mathur Viraha Kantor Vajavasi Ganer Sevakara Amader Pradhan Kartabha. Means Swayam Krishna live Braj, then deep his separation, all Vrajavasis are lamenting. Ghana Sam Gayo Braj Se Parsaki Kahe Gaye Varso Vitae Hai. He told Krishna to I am going today. Tomorrow I will kill Kamsa and thereafter tomorrow come back. Years have been passed, they have come. So how they are lamenting, have to absorb in their mood, have to serve Vrajavasi, this is our main goal of bhajan. If we serve Vrajavasi, Krishna in our hand. Because it mentioned Siddhi Bhavati Baneti Samsayachita Sevinam Nishamsasta Tadbhakta Parijayana Tatmanam. If somebody died serving Krishna, Siddhi Bhavati Baneti, he get perfection, not there is doubt. Why Krishna told himself, Prathamam tu gurum pujya tatascaiva mamarchanam tadesa bhagavat bhakti dhannatha nishphalo bhavet. First you take center of your guna and guru, never reject him. It's very, very big offense. By committing tricks, by others, don't believe. So Prathamam tu gurum pujya, first worship him. Take his permission, come to me and worship. then you can achieve Krishna Bhakti, everything go in vain. So here also, first, Prathamantu Gurum Pujya. So by this way, if we do, then one day, what? The Siddhi Bhavati Bhaneti. That if we get Siddhi or not, direct serving to Krishna, there is doubt. But Nishayam Siddhatvanto Parichaya Ratatmanam. But if we serve His own near and dear, kith and kin, then our Krishna prem in our hand. So what Prabhupada did, how Gour Saraswati told, the place of Toli, Calcutta, don't go. Knowing his inner mood, first established there, and he engaged the bit in Krishna Bhakti. How we can reconcile, Prahlad Maharaj told in his famous lotus leaf, Prayeno deva gunayo savimukta kama maunam charanti vijanina parathanishtha. Telling who is doing his own bhajan, I think is miser. Who is doing bhajan himself, help others, I tell that broad-minded. This is our idea, Gosthanandi. This Gosthanandi, first Prabhupada had sold this. Prabhupada Gosthanandi, Gour Saraswati Bhajanandi, Loknath Goswami Bhajanandi, Narottam Thakur Gosthanandi. If Prabhupada supposed not to appear in this world, maybe none of us supposed to be that here. And following his footsteps, my another Dadu spiritual grandsire, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, he spread his mission all over the world. So we dated to past Gurudev, my Guru Maharaj, Srila Guru Nanshya Maharaj, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, our Param Guru Devan Prabhupada, Hare Krishna. Banchakar Bhutarupas Chatipas Hindu Bhai Vacha, Patitanan Pavanipo, Vaswamipo, Ramana. Again, I am telling that Guru Nanshya disappeared in this city to show the whole world. What purpose Prabhupada came same purpose to show this, he disappeared in this city. What I elaborate explain. Hare Krishna.
Yeah. He was not a miser.
No. Prahlad Maharaj is telling, if he miser, then why initiate Prabhupada? First, he don't want to initiate. But due to his, he saw how broad-minded he is. He is mentioned, Varameka guni putra natu murta satan napi ekastan rata mohanti na chatara lalo abita. One sun, moon can give light, but thousand stars could not give light. The same way, one qualified disciple delivered whole world. To show this, he adopted only one disciple, not so many. Through him, he won.
Yes.
Like Narottam Thakur, Loknath Goswami, Narottam Thakur did, and so the glory of Gurudev is all good.
Very nice glorification of Guru Parampara, especially Srila Gaura Govinda Goswami Maharaj. Yeah, how his glories are so intimately connected with Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada, our Gurudev, Srila Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, all. So we'll have till 9 o'clock approximately one more speaker. And I am requesting the audience, especially senior Vaishnavas, to give chance to our dearmost Bhaktisiddhanta Vaikana Swaras to speak for 15 minutes.
Yeah.
You are going, in 2-3 days you are leaving us. And we want that your presence should be established here. Yeah. Amongst all the audience. Srila Bhaktivedanta Vaikana Swaras is a very powerful speaker, preacher, very dedicated to follow the order of our Guru Parampara, his own Guru Maharaj, and his Shiksha Guru, our beloved Gurudev. He is preaching in Bangalore, and what he is doing, only he can understand, but we don't understand something. So we want to hear from his lotus lips the glories of Srila Gour Govinda Goswami Maharaj and Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada.
Vachapapadurvachachipasirudevcha. Kitaro phalayo
So I begin by offering a most humble obeisances to the lotus feet of my beloved gurus. And to Srila Bhakti, Vishnu, Vishnava, Astoka, Sissima, Bhakti, Vedanta, Swami, Maharaja, Gautama. Same heartfelt obeisances and the lotus feet of Srila Talila Bhavishta, Om Vishnava, Astoka, Sissima, Bhakti, Vedanta, Maharaja, Gautama. And on this day to our beloved God brother, Sri Nityalila, the Vishra, or Vishakara, Vastra, Parasata Sisima, Bhakti, Sri Gour Govinda Goswami Maharaj, and unto our Param Gurudev, Sri Nityalila, Vishra, Vishakara, Vastra, Parasata Sisima, Bhaktisidhanta, Saraswati, Goswami. So, we heard in a very beautiful way the conjunction of the intent and desire and mission of Sri Gour Govinda Maharaj with Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada. This was very nicely described by Sri Prabhupada Maharaj, which illuminated the unity of purpose and mission of our dear beloved godbrother, exalted godbrother, and that of his Param Gurudev and preceptor and his own guru, Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. And this is the real glory of him. The glory of the disciple is how consistently, accurately, they maintain, understand, and present the Manubhishta of their predecessors. I spoke to this point the other day that we are all following in the line of Rupa Goswami. We are called Rupa Nubis. And the glory of Rupa Goswami is cited Sri Chaitanya Manubhishtam Stavitam Jaina Bhutale Sayam Rupa Kadamayan Vidati Sayam. That we all offer our most respectful and humble obeisances to Sri Rupa Goswami. We take shelter of his lotus feet because he has so perfectly understood the internal moods and desires of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and revealed them to the world. And our great acharyas from that line have been known to the degree and extent that they have been able to do that. So, talking about Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada, his glory, if you can say his glory, because it's actually his glory, but to just extract one small part of his glory, which more or less reveals and explains the rest, is that he perfectly represented and follow the order of his Diksha Guru, but even more, his Shiksha Guru, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. We've been speaking about Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur a little bit in the last few days, and if we understand the magnitude of the mission that Bhaktivinoda Thakur accepted, coming into India at the time that he did, when practically Gaudiya Vaishnava conceptions, the mission of Mahaprabhu was covered in darkness, covered in misrepresentation, the works of the Goswamis lost, forgotten, those who were so-called Gaudiya Vaishnavas completely misrepresenting, the entire nation under the grip of the British Raj, who were encouraging everyone to completely abandon this pure and beautiful theistic conception and go to the modern materialistic scientific point of view. The magnitude of the task to overcome this was so amazing. And yet, Bhaktivinoda Thakur did that. He's known as Saptam Goswami, the seventh Goswami, because he accomplished in Srivandavapur and everywhere he went the mission that the Goswamis were tasked by Mahaprabhu to do, namely to rediscover the lost pilgrimage places. Perhaps in Vrindavan, so many of those are still remembered, but in Mayapur, the non-violence of Sri Krishna. And he wrote Sri Mahatma to reestablish and to bring that memory back, to rediscover the birthplace of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, which has been 400 years in physical contact, to reestablish and explain and to write further the literature of the Goswamis, which he did. All of this without help, the degree of his work, and yet he knew that his work had just begun. The work of Mahaprabhu had just begun. And even though, in a vision, looking across from Trigodrum over to the Antrigate, Mayapur's side, envisioning that one day grand temples glorifying Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would be erected, and that devotees from all over the world, from all races, would be coming together to chant and glorify with Sri Harinam Sankirtan the glories of Sri Krishna, Radha Krishna, Mahaprabhu. Seeing all this, he knew that this was not his task. He had laid this incredible foundation, but he knew someone was needed, and he prayed, just as Advaita Acharya had prayed very deeply that the Lord himself come and appear. So Sri Bhaktivinoda also prayed that, my Lord, this work is unfinished. Please send your own special representative. He prayed for a ray of Vishnu, that he would appear. And then, as we've heard, in Jagannath Puri, in that most auspicious place, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada did appear according to the desire and prayer of Srila Bhaktivinoda. And just as we heard that for a period of time, his birthplace was reaffirmed later by Lord Jagannath, at the time when Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada was born, at that time he was given the name Bimala Prasad by Srila Bhaktivinoda. Bimala Devi is the consort of Lord Jagannath. And so in that sense, she is not different from Srimati Radhika. She is her direct expansion. And because he had prayed to the Lord himself that this special person be sent, and he knew by the marks on his body, by the fact that his umbilical cord is wrapped around his body like a Brahmin thread, the marks on his body, the natural tilak appeared there, his complexion is radiant, the astrological chart was incredible. He knew this is the one that has been sent. He says that this is the mercy of Bhimala Devi himself. And so a few months later, as we know, when it was time for his first grain-taking ceremony, the Jagannath brought the Rath Yatra was going on, and for some reason the cart stopped just a few hundred meters from the place that it had started. I mean, the house of Bhaktivinoda, where he was living as magistrate, is at the place where the Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is now. And it's not very far from the temple, just a short walk up the road. And the cart stopped. And no matter what they did, they could not get it to move, because Lord Jagannath, he travels of his own volition. And so for 3 days, the kirtan was going. Why? Because Lord Jagannath wanted to acknowledge and he wanted to see his special servant. Finally, on the third day, the wife of Bhaktivinoda Thakur came out from the house with her child, and because Bhaktivinoda Thakur was the magistrate, she was allowed up onto the cart with this child, and she placed her at the feet of Lord Jagannath. And at that time, one of the Lord's garlands fell all around the child. Everybody understood that. That's a very auspicious sign. Vaishnavas, they take special note of events like that. And then she also took Jagannath Prasad, and that was the first grain that this child had taken, directly from the cart and the plate of Lord Jagannath. And then, throughout his childhood, he became, as Gurudev would use the term, like the shadow of his exalted father. And from the youngest age, he was hearing his father's teachings, he was assisting his father, going with him, carrying his books, and following in his footsteps. By the age of 5, he'd already learned the entire Bhagavad Gita. At a very young age, he had absorbed the lessons of Srimad Bhagavatam, the lessons of Rupa Goswami, all the teachings that Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur was accumulating and expounding on this young boy, who was a Shrutidhara. Whatever he heard one time, he would remember perfectly. And he would absorb completely all of these teachings. And he was also very bold. Just like we've come to realize our acharyas, those who are following the line of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada, they have also taken on this quality. He was completely bold and, what is the word, completely inflexible in accommodating any misconception, any trace of mayavad, any accommodation for materialism. Very, very, very powerful personality. And it became clear from a very young time that this was the person who was destined to carry on this mission. He was admitted to university, and he was very accomplished as a scholar. From a very young age, actually, he had become practically the topmost astrologer in all of India. And he rewrote and made commentary and republished the Surya Siddhanta, the authoritative treatise on all Vedic astrology. And he was so accomplished that the president, or what do you call the leader of the University of Calcutta, had offered him the chairmanship of that special department. And he said, no, I have not come to this world to teach anything like that, about the motion of planets and astrology and karma and fate. I have come for a much higher purpose. And he refused the chair. And yet, his qualification was so high that the chairman decided that we cannot offer this to anybody as long as he is living. And they held that chair open for the entire lifetime of Srila Saraswati Prabhupada. But Srila Prabhupada very quickly began to follow in the footsteps of his father and began to preach very vigorously. One time, when he was still quite young, maybe early 20s, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur had been invited to an assembly to teach or to give a speech on the comparative or relative position of Brahmins and Vaishnavas. Because Gaudiya Vaishnava teachings from the time of Mahaprabhu were very unsettling to the orthodox Brahminical community, because they were teaching that a Vaishnava is actually higher than a Brahmin, that a genuine Vaishnava has transcended the conditions of birth that would classify one as Shudra, Vaishya, Kshatriya, or Brahmin. And Bhaktivinoda Thakur addresses that in Jiva Dharma, a very controversial point for a culture that was so rigidly attached to status determined by birth. But Bhaktivinoda Thakur had established otherwise, and this was a point of contention. So he was invited to speak, but on the plea of illness, he said, I cannot attend, just as Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur set his own Baladev Vidyabhusan into the teeth of the entire controversy with all these learned scholars, he sent his own son. And so Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati, Bhima Prasad, he went to that place. And on the first day, you had all this big line, Vaishnavas on one side and Brahmins on the other, very formal assembly. Everybody was waiting with bated breath while waiting to hear the speaker. A very young man. And he began by glorifying Brahmins. And he glorified Brahmins from Shastra so much, for hours and hours and hours. He was citing shlokas that no Brahmins had ever heard before. And they were so happy. Oh, he has understood our position. Oh, he's just a great personality. Yes, 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 go on, go, glorify. And they were so happy. Brahmins are the topmost, Brahmins are this, Brahmins are that. Yes, 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 oh, very good, sadhu, sadhu. Practically a full day. But then the next day, He began to glorify Vaishnava. And he established not only the glory of Vaishnavas, but the preeminence of Vaishnavas above all others. And again, his Shastric reference was so irrefutable, so powerful, that nobody could say a word. They were stunned into silence and shocked and defeated and depressed, of course. Except for those who are very intelligent and could take the kernel, the core of the message, and appreciate it. But there's always two sides. Those that are submissive and appreciative, and those who are still engaged, as Bhaktivinoda Thakura says, in the mood of passive or active hostility. But still, nevertheless, he defeated them all. And as he had proved to do for the rest of his life, nobody could stand up to the power of his intellect and the power of his capacity to reference Shastra. Because whenever he always spoke from scripture. And when he was going to university, his intention in going to the university was that they had a very large library. And so he wanted to avail himself. At that time in India, not so many scriptures were available to everyone. So this is one of the greatest collections of Vedic literature. And he would spend all his time in the library reading, 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 and of course memorizing everything. And after he had finished reading, he just dropped out. And in fact, he was doing very poorly in school. And he confided to one of his friends that, "I don't want to do very well in school. Because if I do very well, they'll think I'm an intelligent fellow. And if I'm an intelligent fellow, they will put so many expectations on me for worldly success. So let them think that I'm not very qualified, that I'm a fool, and let me get on with my business." And so he left the school after he had read all the books, just as we heard from Maharaj, that after he had left the service of the king, actually, he had completed his real task. He had injected the sun with the kernel, with the seed of bhakti, but also that king had a very vast library. Many of the books were not available elsewhere, and he had read and studied and remembered all of them as well. And in fact, it came to be that he was so expert in all of the different studies of the different sampradayas. He knew the tattva of the Ramanuja Sampradaya, of the Madhva Sampradaya, of all of the different groups better than their acharyas did. And over the years, if many of them had a question about what their own siddhanta was, well, if it was very complicated, there was some dispute, they would have to go to him to understand it. Such a powerful, he was like the world acharya. But the mission had not been manifest yet. And so his father, wondering what he will do, but after the job of the king failed, he thought, "Oh, what will my son do?" So he thought, well then, he had purchased that land, he had established that place in Mayapur, so he sent Srila Saraswati Prabhupada there to maintain the place. And it was there that he decided that he would do his bhajan and prepare himself. So he had made a vow that I will stay in this dham and not leave until I have chanted 1 billion names. That would be, if you chanted 3 lakhs a day, it would take you 10 years to chant that many rounds. As it turns out, he actually completed it in about 7 and a half. So strict was his vow. And again, he was eating only once a day, just a little bit of rice and maybe dal and just in a very simple way off the ground, completely dedicated in bhajan. And you can imagine Mayapur back then, there was no internet, no TV, no electricity, no running water, nothing. He was simply absorbed in deep bhajan, not concerned with anything else, preparing himself in that way. Then it came to be that Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakura also began to enter his sickness pastimes, and he was to leave this world about 1914. But before he left, he sent a special message to his son, a special letter, which is recorded. And he told him, he called him Siddhanta Saraswati, he said that he more or less instructed him in his future mission. He explained that he had done so much, but now that he wanted him to take up the service of Sri Dhammayapur, which he had done his bhajan to prepare himself for, and he said that, "I consider that the publishing and distribution of transcendental literature to be real service to Sri Dhammayapur." And he encouraged him to maintain very good conduct, very good character, to not associate with worldly people, and to serve Sri Dhammayapur by this act of informing the world through Harinam Kirtan and transcendental distribution of literature, publication and distribution of the Bhagavad. And he took this to heart. Now, there's a story about that time afterwards. Now, I remember in Malaysia, when we were there on this same day, when Srila Gurudev was there in the house of Dr. Param and his wife, Gurudev asked us all to speak a little bit. And I told this story. And Gurudev said, "Where have you heard this story?" And I said, "Oh, there's a whole bunch of them. I've never heard this before." Anyway, I heard this story from our guru told it, and we heard it the other night from Srila Bharti Maharaj as well. So this story is within the Vaishnav community, but Gurudev was making the point that he had never heard it from Bhakti Vyankesh Maharaj, so for him, it didn't exist. You know, that this is his mission. But I've heard this from other gurus, so I'm going to tell the story. Not as an offense to Gurudev, but because it's part of Gaudiya Vaishnav lore, and we heard it the other night as well, that there was a period when Srila Saraswati Prabhupada was uncertain about how he would push this mission on. Because as we heard, he didn't have anybody, no followers. How would he do it? And then he had a transcendental spurti or vision of Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakura along with our Guru Bhargava, Rupa Goswami, Sanatana Goswami, and all coming to him and saying, "Have no fear. Push on. They are all coming. So many qualified people are being sent." And Srila Bharti Maharaj said the other night that the people that were sent to follow Srila Saraswati Prabhupada were also special parigars of Mahaprabhu. And he gave so many stories about their glories so Srila Saraswati Prabhupada, he was the leader of such great personalities. So many exalted pure devotees came and they were his disciples. When you think about the personalities, Bhakti Prabhupada, Puri Goswami Maharaj, Srila Bhakti Rakshak, Srila Goswami Maharaj, Srila Bhakti Vyankesha Goswami Maharaj, Srila Bhakti Dayata Madhava Maharaj, Srila Asi Bhakti Swami Prabhupada, the list is endless. How exalted these persons were, and he was their guru, their leader, their inspiration, the one chosen to direct all these powerful generals in their mission of establishing the Bhakti Vinod Dara, what Bhakti Vinod Thakura had with so much labor and effort, laid this foundation, established this vast body of literature, brought up the teachings, revealed them to everybody, established Mahaprabhu's place. Now they were to take all of this and put it into some format and spread it throughout the world. And the format he created was the Gaudiya Math. Gaudiya Math was created as a place. What is a math? What's the difference between a math and a temple? Throughout history, most people just go to temples. They go there, they do some incense, they put a little money down, they ask the deity for something, and then they go away. But a math is like a spiritual university. It's a place where you go to train, to absorb the teachings, to become imbued with spiritual quality, and when you become qualified, then you go out on the order of your guru, and you spread those teachings. This is Audarya. This is the mood of Mahaprabhu. That as Krishna exemplified this mood of sweetness, Mahaprabhu's mood, also sweet, was dominated by this mood of Audarya or munificence. To take that inner sweetness and spread it throughout the world. And so he established Gaudiya Math, not one, but 64, indicating all of the limbs of bhakti. And to share those limbs of bhakti, and then that was not enough, but to give the order and the power for those that same mission, that same model, to be spread throughout the entire world. And for that, he ordered his different disciples. He began by first going to England and Germany, but then, within his own lifetime, it had not been fully accomplished, but he knew it. And he said, and there's a very famous speech that he gave upon the return of his disciples from England, that we've expended so much of the lifeblood of the Gaudiya Math to send preachers abroad. And we've met with some success, but not full success. He said, but never mind, because I predict very, very soon, one of us will go, and we'll go to the West, and then the flood of Mahaprabhu's teachings will spread throughout the world. And by the power of that statement, that such a sankalpa, it came to pass. Because this was the wish of not just Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada, because he was following the order of his gurus, Gaur Kishoras Babaji Maharaj and Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, who were following the orders of their gurus all the way to Mahaprabhu himself. Yadi Deke Yadi Kaha Krishna Upadesh, Amara Agyaya Guruhana Tara Edesh. Wherever you are, wherever you meet, wherever you go, you take this message of Mahaprabhu, this message of Krishna, and to the best of your ability, you teach it to everyone. You spread this mission throughout the land. In this way, you become qualified. You become a guru. This is a message for all of us. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada and his followers wanted all of us to become gurus. That doesn't mean we all take disciples, but it means to the best of our ability, all of us imbibe these teachings and share them with others. And this was the Gaudiya Math. The Gaudiya Math, they were so active and so energetic with printing presses, publishing so many literature, so many translations, flooding India. At a time, this had never been heard of, this kind of evangelicalism in Indian, in, you know, Christianity, they're evangelical. The Hindu culture was reserved and internal. Not so aggressive, very passive. And but he had a different mood, and he went everywhere. That's why when you go to somebody Gaudiya Math, you see at the gates this elephant being pounced on by this lion ripping this elephant up, and you think, what's this? Elephants are so nice. Why is this lion chewing on this elephant? But the elephant represents the misconceptions, the powerful misconceptions of materialism and Mayavada. And the lion represents the lion-like acharyas of our line who have come to overcome and destroy all of that. And he certainly was. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada certainly was. And by his power, he gave that energy to all of our gurus, so many people representing different branches coming from the line of Saraswati Prabhupada. Actually, we could go on for hours about this. I know there's not time. Just to drop. Just one last thing about something about Gaur Govinda Maharaj. I don't know so much about him, only what I've heard and what I've read. And the amazing thing about him is when we first got some of his books when we were in our little Bangalore mutt, we were reading them. Actually, it was Bhagavan and his son, Srila, who brought The Banks of Separation, and we began to read it in the morning. And I thought, is this one of Gurudev's books? Because his teachings and his method of presentation was so aligned with the way that Gurudev did, I couldn't detect the difference. I could not detect the difference. It was such an amazing and beautiful thing. And I recall a few stories about him. You know the story when Sanatana Goswami first came to meet Mahaprabhu? Mahaprabhu sent his servant, who was a Tapa Misha, he sent him outside. He sent a Vaishnava outside. And Tapa Misha looked out the door and he just saw this ragged Muslim mendicant. And he said, "No, there's no one out there." And he closed the door and he went back. And he said, "No, no, someone is out there. Bring them in." It was Sanatana Goswami, who externally could not be detected because he had been traveling and he was still in the appearance as he had been as a servant of Mahaprabhu, Saint Shah, with the beard and the hair, etc. But Mahaprabhu recognized his eternal servant and he called him in and the bond was reestablished. So in the same way, the way I've heard it, when Srila Gaura Govinda Maharaj first came, he'd seen this back to Godhead. He read the book and he said, "Now at last, the person who I have been looking for, who's perfectly representing the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, this is him." He knew it. His heart had been awakened by these instructions that he detected in the Bhakti Godhead. And he immediately went to that monk. And when he tried to get entrance to Srila Prabhupada's quarters, one of our God brothers, guardians, because it's very hard to get into Sri Srila Prabhupada. Somebody always think, "No, you cannot see Prabhupada." Very difficult. So, Gaura Govinda Maharaj just looked like another Baba, a mendicant who'd been traveling around by foot all over India for years and years. So, what was his condition? Vrindavan is filled with these people. "No, you're not going to waste Prabhupada's time. Go. You can't see him." And he waited and waited and they wouldn't let him in. But then Srila Prabhupada said, "There's someone outside that wants to see me?" "No, no, Prabhupada." "Yes, yes, there is. Someone, bring them in." And then he brought him in and then he said, "Oh," and had that conversation. "Have you taken sannyas?" "No, I will give you sannyas." The bond was established immediately. The bond already existed, but it was waiting to be established again. And then within a very short time, he was put in charge of translation because he was a scholar of Srila Prabhupada's books in Oriya and also Hindi. And then he came in 74, as you say. In 1975, early in 75, at the time of I believe, Gaura Purnima, then one of our God brothers was going to take sannyas, Chukrori, and one other. I can't remember. And then Srila Prabhupada said, "I want to give him, Gaura Govinda, also sannyas." And all these Western sannyasis that were there with him, our God brothers, God bless them all. "You can't give him sannyas. He's a new boy. He's a new boy." Even though he was, you know, of age and quality. And Srila Prabhupada became so angry. I said, "New boy! You are the new boys! He is a pure devotee from birth. You are the new boys. I am giving him sannyas." And so, nobody knew. Most of the others didn't know. And so he wanted to go over to he set the ceremony up. And there were two seats, everybody knew these two were taking sannyas, and then there was another seat. And I said, "Who's that one for? Who's that other? You know, extra 7 o'clock, extra stick, the name for, who's the one?" And he's setting up, and then the other two come sit down, and then he sits down. Everybody goes, "What? What?" But he took sannyas, and the rest is history. His preaching was so powerful all over the world. What he did inspired so many people, and so many of the people that later would come to Srila Gurudev came because of their connection and exposure with Srila Gaura Govinda Maharaj. His teaching and preaching was so powerful. And there was a time in Mayapur, no, I won't speak to that, but when he first manifested in an almost uncontrolled way these inner symptoms of spiritual love and ecstasy, it was so overwhelming, none of the devotees could understand it. And it went on for some time. They thought he was ill, they thought he was sick, and they were going to take him to some doctor, But then Krishna's Babaji Maharaj came, a disciple of Srila Bhaktisidhanta Saraswati, but the same one who had been in the sannyas ceremony of Srila Prabhupada. And he came and they asked him, can you detect what's wrong? What's happening? And he walked up and he looked at him. And I think he took maybe a little cup and he put it by his nose. And then he just smiled and said, no problem, Bob! And then he just, Hare Krishna, and he walked out and disappeared chanting. That was it. And he just acknowledged and established that this was not some weird sickness, just as Mahaprabhu had been diagnosed with epilepsy or some problem with the light airs. The devotees were so confused, they'd never seen anything like that. But he didn't want, he was never manifesting this intentionally in any way, but this was out of his control, and this was Krishna's desire to show that this is a really amazing and separate personality. But even more than that, the way that he was preaching and the books that ultimately came out based on his teaching, this established his real glory. That the external manifestations of spiritual ecstasy, this is not the proof of a devotee, but how that devotee can change and uplift the characters of others, this is the real mark of a Vaishnava. And one time they asked our Guru Srila Prabhupada, because there are so many people coming from India who are claiming they can do this miracle or that miracle, they had this city or that city, and they asked Srila Prabhupada, well, Swami, can you do miracles? And he said, yes. He said, well, my real miracle is that I have taken these boys and girls who were so attached to intoxication, illicit sex, gambling, and meat eating, and turn them into saintly devotees of God. This is the real miracle. And so Govinda Maharaj's real miracle was that. That he took so many and uplifted them, and so many of the prominent, active, and saintly persons today come in his line. His followers, so many of them, are so exemplary, so qualified, so humble and so dedicated. This is the glory. A good tree produces good fruit. And Govinda Maharaj certainly produced wonderful, wonderful fruit. So on this day we offer our obeisances, humble obeisances, prayerful obeisances to his lotus feet, begging for a particle of his mercy, and of course to our Paramgurudev and preceptor and the establisher of Gaudiya Mats all over the world, the grandfather of ISKCON, and all modern Gaudiya Vaishnava, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Prabhupada, and to all the followers and assembled devotees, Jai. Vajra Kapoor, 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 Vajra Kapoor,